Looking back, I would say many of us, or majority of us, have one or the other fond memories of going out or living the life a little different. And we will say consider December 2019, Jan 2020 as those milestone time before and after types, right? Before Corona, after Corona. So the need of the hour, I believe, is to right now we are all experiencing some or the other. We are now exposed to the healthcare sector. We are more aware of the healthcare sector, the lacunas there, or the how do we need to scale up, or why do we need to scale up more than ever. And the need of the hour is to look back at some of the great things what we have done before anywhere in the globe, and to look at how APIs or how digitization in general can be brought into the healthcare to help us face a few scenario like this in the future better. Let's equip ourselves better. And to enlighten us, to share with us some great thoughts, great insights from his experience, we are joined by Dr. S.S. Lal. He is the president at Global Foundation for Health and Hygiene currently. He has over 2 decades of experience working with the WHO and with over 25 plus countries. He has done, he is an active participant in the public health policy and of different international organizations in this space across the globe. Welcome, Lal.
Thank you very much.
Can you share your screen? Yeah.
Yeah, I have shared my screen.
Yes, can you see? Yes.
And you can hear
me
well, right?
Yes, yes. Yeah, yes.
Thank you. So, good morning to everyone. Yeah, good morning to everyone. Basically, I'm a medical doctor who got later trained in public health and who has, as Prasanth has pointed out, has worked in WHO. I was mostly working in the area of tuberculosis, HIV, malaria, these kind of infectious diseases. And tuberculosis is one area where this digitization happened much earlier. So I'll be speaking from the point of view of a public health person, a medical doctor, who has been part of some of this, who has been, I should say, watching or witnessing some of this digitization in healthcare. And so I'm not a technical person who can talk into the depth of digitization, but I'm an end user, or a person who has witnessed how things change in health, especially in my area. So I'll be focusing on my area specifically. So let us start with why digitization in healthcare. And as we know, there is increasing rise of on-demand healthcare. On one's own schedule, people expect healthcare services. And more than 4 billion people are globally on the internet, that's the estimate. And big data in healthcare also. And blockchain and the promise of better electronic health records. This is the kind of premises. And how it works, I'm sure many of you will be aware of what's happening, but for those who have not dealt with or who have not understood how digitization healthcare work, I think this will be useful. So the digitization transformation is the positive impact of technology in healthcare. There are several examples. We now talk about telemedicine, especially because of COVID. You cannot go to hospitals. If you have some other illness, you don't want to get disease from the hospital. So people depend a lot on telemedicine. And artificial intelligence, we'll talk about that in the course of the presentation. And blockchain, electronic health records. And they're completely replacing the, reshaping the interaction with health professionals. How data is shared and how decisions are made about treatment and even outcomes. And this streamlines physicians' work. It optimizes systems, improves patient outcomes, reduces human error, and lowers costs. So digitization has helped health service providers create robust infrastructure by focusing on patients' needs. This is from a presentation on by another agency. I have given the reference. So we all know more or less about this. It's predicted that 6 technologies will transform healthcare, which include telehealth, we already spoke about that. Artificial intelligence, we'll be speaking more about that. 3D printing, which can create anatomical models and design custom devices and tools, which can enhance precision in medication. And augmented and virtual reality that can simulate medical procedures, ease pain symptoms and treat conditions, even conditions like dementia. And there are wearable health monitors, all of us know, including watches that can measure your pulse rate or document your ECG. And next generation sequencing that can identify risk at-risk population and target therapies to patient response, or direct to consumer genetic testing, which many of us might have done. And there are some benefits from digitization of health. I have mentioned some of them. It lowers the rate of medication errors. There was a kind of discussion. That discussion, the argument is still going on. Whether tools can, especially electronic tools, can replace the doctors. No, you need a doctor. You need a person to see the patient. You need person-to-person interaction. At the same time, when you introduce digital tools, it lowers the errors, human errors, especially human errors. And it promotes preventive care, predicts more accurate staffing. We all know about it. And you can treat patients with virtual reality. We discussed about wearable medical devices. And it can predict healthcare using information aggregated through big data. And artificial intelligence, we'll be discussing that. And blockchain and better electronic health records. So I told you TB disease. I work in the area of tuberculosis. And I am giving some examples from the field of tuberculosis. Before that, I'll tell you what is the TB burden and what are the gaps in fighting tuberculosis. I have, even these days, when I was traveling 1 year ago at least, there used to be people sitting beside me, educated people, some are ministers, some people, including ministers of India, they have asked me, when I tell them I am working in the area of tuberculosis, many people have asked me, is tuberculosis not that eradicated from the country? No. What? Look at the numbers. TB is still the biggest killer among all infectious diseases, more than HIV. Globally, 10 million people get TB every year. In Indian terms, it is 1 crore patients every year globally. And of that, 10 million, 2.7 million is in India. India is the highest TB burden country. And what happens is, we have medicines to cure TB from 1940s. And today, it's a completely curable disease. TB is a completely curable disease. Still, we get 10 million cases every year. All the primary health centers in India and all over the world, they have free TB medicines. But still, people get TB. So many people with TB may not get diagnosed at all. Some 30% of the people of this 10 million, they were missing. They don't get reported. And diagnosed patients, they may not seek treatment. They will say, oh, I don't need your treatment. I'll take some other home remedy or some other treatment. And patients who receive treatment may not adhere to treatment. That's one of the biggest problems. 6 months, you need 6 months, at least 6 months. Patients have to take at least 6 months treatment. After 2 or 3 weeks, patients feel better and they stop treatment. And patients who are TB patients on treatment may not get notified, as I told you. That's a big problem in India also. Some 30-40% of the people, they go to private sector. It could be anything ranging from a traditional healer to a big hospital. And they may not, usually they don't report to national programs. So government doesn't have information about at least 30% of the patients. Where also this digitization is helping us a lot. So I'll come to a couple of examples. Earlier, diagnosis of TB was a complex procedure. You have to go and take out your sputum, cuff out your sputum into a bottle, and give it to the laboratory. You have to go next day again, give sample, maybe a couple of samples, one morning and one at the lab, and 3 samples. And you may get the result next day. So it was a cumbersome procedure, 3 days, 4 days, maybe it could be even up to a week when you have a disease like TB. Now things have changed. The sputum can be taken in a cartridge and it can be connected to a computer and you get the result in 90 minutes. 90 minutes you can know whether you have TB or not. Sorry. The other thing is an example of, I told you, people discontinue treatment, which is a big issue. You get treatment free of cost and you interrupt the treatment and you get drug-resistant TB, which is very difficult to cure. And you have to spend thousands of dollars to, even if you get cured. So what happens is people interrupt treatment. Not because they don't want to take, they may forget, it could be due to ignorance. So now we have electronic drug boxes. When the patient takes a medicine, there is a message going to the provider, so he or she knows that this patient is taking medicine. If he doesn't do that, there will be a reminder call or SMS. There are mechanisms to follow. These are a couple of examples from a lot of digitization happened in the area of TB. I'm giving an example from a company called Dure Technology, which is based in Geneva. So they are trying to connect all stakeholders, you know, patient care to national data system, and using digital tools. So it connects among surveillance, programmatic management, e-learning, patient care. From they have patient module and provider module. So it interfaces each stakeholder and empowering patients based on their health facility and providing them with personalized health advice, supporting them through treatment journeys and improving treatment success by facilitating more robust programs. So this is how, this is one example. I'm not taking much time because we have only 20 minutes to finish the presentation. So this is being widely used globally, especially in TB program.
Introduces the NTB application suite. Taking the Filipinos' battle against TB to the digital arena. A war that every one of us must wage. With digital technology as the weapon and tool for communication that is within the reach of everyone. And uniting the whole community with ease of use and navigation, addressing all our needs to attain a TB-free Philippines. The Care TB app is designed for the use of the whole community. It is the caring ally of the TB patient.
So this is an example from, this was an example from Philippines. The video shows an example how patient-centric application enables patient to self-report and initiate their treatment journey for tuberculosis. And this is another example which is being used in family planning. And it's again about triangulation of data. And this shows how a centralized data warehousing works. This is collecting and managing data from varied sources and then provides meaningful insights. So it helps in data analysis on real-time basis and reporting. So this is again a platform built for sustainability and this highly scalable. So this can be used. This can be prepared for a country, and this can be used for other countries also. They have created systems like that. They have a global template. It can be adapted for countries, and it can be integrated with other programs. And a similar country with some adaptation, they can also use it. All these are being used in the area of TB and other similar diseases. And this is another example from another company, Cure. I was working closely with these organizations, and even today I'm closely working with them. Until last July, I was in the US heading a global TB, heading a global department of Family Health International. Before that, I was with PATH and then WHO. So I've been working with all these organizations closely. And this is about, I told you, tuberculosis. Tuberculosis, doing this computerized test is expensive. $40 to $50 you have to spend. So you don't have to do this test in every suspected patient. So you can screen patients. So X-ray is one tool to screen. It's like screening TB, people with suspected TB. So there can be thousands of X-rays. Maybe a small percentage of them could be TB. But when a physician sits and looks at these X-rays, it's very time consuming. So artificial intelligence is being used in finding possible TB patients from X-rays. So, and this may software can detect 27 other chest abnormalities also, and this is being deployed in 40 countries. Indians also have a major stake in this and the development of this tool. And this is making things easier, especially in view of the COVID and other issues where patients cannot go to all places, and they can go to X-ray centers and then they can be screened by software or machine sitting remotely. And this, they have another innovation. When you don't have hospitals with all kinds of facilities, you have problems. You'll have to, patient will have to go to multiple hospitals. So this can be arranged in a hospital or it can be in a van. You, the patient goes into a van, he gets that X-ray done, and X-ray is read by the machine sitting somewhere else. Software, in a minute, if it is a suspected TB case, that machine will tell you. And the radiologist can review only the selected or the suspected X-rays. Then they can have confirmatory tests like the computerized one. And if that patient is having TB, he can be sent to the hospital for treatment the same day. It used to take, you know, several days in the past. Now, the same day, in a few hours, patient get be diagnosed and started on treatment. And this is being used in COVID. Frontline workers and physicians can immediately identify COVID suspects using this X-ray software and all. They can see on their mobile phone. And this is another patient monitoring platform. This is being deployed in Oman and for monitoring COVID infected individuals using a chatbot. So what is a digital print in healthcare? Especially, I gave examples from my own area, tuberculosis. So what is digital imprint? So numerous tools and resources are there that can improve healthcare services. And this has reshaped doctor-patient experience. And healthcare providers have more tools and resources now. Patients receive better care and more accessible treatment. And after everything, we have the most important thing, more transparency in healthcare. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lal, for sharing your rich experience, some stories from your rich experience. Just wanted to know, how do you see the, say, on a scale of, say, 1 to 10, where do you rate the Indian healthcare system in terms of digitization, and what are those top two things that you would say the healthcare sector need to adopt so as to face such a situation better in the future?
See, at national level, I would rate somewhere around 2 or 3. But there are settings where things have improved a lot, especially in some cities. For example, I have worked in Mumbai. We had done a project. Mm-hmm. They have gone ahead of many other parts. There is political commitment, or there is investment from donor agents like Gates and other agencies. So, and coming to Kerala, we are much ahead of many other states. And the TB, the TB program where I worked, actually that was, at least the data transmission was digitized in late 90s. Because I joined WHO in 99, already we had a software. When even laptop was a wonderful thing, or what do you call it, a special thing in India, I used to use my laptop to send the data, TB data of Kerala and Tamil Nadu, Lakshadweep, these areas, electronically to the IT person in Delhi. That used to happen in 99. Yeah, so, yeah. What we lack is, see, there are major other diseases which are yet to adopt digitization, including See, people were saying that this is like malaria or HIV, these kind of major diseases should learn from TB. I don't know to what extent they have done it. Plus, non-communicable diseases. Usually, poor countries will have communicable diseases. Richer countries will have non-communicable diseases because they all live for longer years and they get diseases like diabetes or heart, blood pressure, this kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But India has the dual burden. We have both. And I'm sure the non-communicable diseases, digitization has not happened to a great extent. See, how many of you know, who are using some kind of reminders for a BP medicine, which they have to take mostly lifelong. And if they miss those, they can get struck. Or if people miss diabetes injection, they can get into complications of diabetes. So how many patients do you know? We have patients at home among our friends. Do you know anyone who is being monitored by some mechanism? So non-communicable diseases are being neglected, especially in this particular area.
Right. Okay. Thanks a lot, sir. I think okay, yeah, there is one more question. So, do we have any open source API data available for healthcare disease and case info?
See, because of your technical jargons, I didn't understand the question clearly. If you can.
They're asking is it's like organizations or government will collate the case data of any particular disease and will be made available. For anybody who can access it and do more research on it or come up with any value-added offerings or anything on top of it. But it will be made available via an API, the integration mechanism that we are focusing on in this event, actually. So, actually, it will be made available in an electronic media. That's what on an on-demand basis.
Systems are available in India, as you know. We don't have shortage or in systems. Everything is there. But the quality of this reporting system is very compromised. And so that's one thing. And still, we rely a lot on paper reports. Even a state like Kerala, we rely a lot on paper reports, especially at lower levels. TB program is an exception, but many programs. And we had a very funny incident many years ago. Now, people write on papers sitting in a tea shop or something like that. Somebody else copies and somebody put a wrong tick mark on guinea worm. And this came up to the director of health service and it went to Delhi. And Delhi people were shocked to see that there is guinea worm in Kerala. So there was a commission appointed for 3 months to verify, check and find out where it's happening. Finally, we found out that somebody put a wrong tick. So this is how things happen even in a state like Kerala. So paper reporting is a big problem and data quality management.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot, sir, for joining us here and sharing your valuable insights. And all the best and thank you again on the specific, on one specific thing, the COVID helpline. I'm aware that you're running a COVID-specific helpline at the state of Kerala. So thanks a lot for your efforts in helping the affected. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.